Hi, Anirudh.
Hello, sir. How are you?
I am good. It's just the two of us right now. People will come in gradually. That's not a problem.
Okay, sure, sure.
How is everything going with you?
Good, sir. I'm simultaneously now attending two webinars right now. आपका और एक simultaneously recording पे लगा है.
चल कोई बात नहीं. अभी आप पीपीई के लिए क्या कर रहे हो निरुद्ध?
I'm just sketching, working out, reading, attending these webinars. चल रहा
है. It will soon require PPEs, no?
Yeah, that is there. We will need PPEs.
मिल ही नहीं रहा है अभी. And they are like charging a bomb, you know, 1300 plus GST for one PPE.
बाप रे. That's too much.
तो पूरा मतलब it comes from the head to toes, like even feet and everything needs to be covered, no?
अच्छा.
तो उसके लिए है सर. अच्छा है. That is good.
एक मिनट सर, I'll just log in again through the other computer. इस पे recording के लिए दूसरा लगाता हूँ.
कोई बात नहीं अनिरुद्ध, no problem. Go ahead.
Isha, the done speaking of it.
Hello, everybody. How are you doing?
Hello, everybody. How are you doing?
Can you please mute yourself, all of you? And then we can, as soon as we have some more participants, we'll be starting. Basically, this is the repeat lecture of part one and part two. So it's going to be more on, I'll combine the two. So it's going to be very short and I'm going to be a little fast because we need to cover lots of topics in approximately 2 hours of time that we may have today. The part three would be done on Friday at 4 o'clock because we have this another simultaneously Roar webinar series going on. So to respect that, our orthodontic webinar series, I am not scheduling any webinar on Friday. But tomorrow I also have a webinar on by Colgate expert lecture series on adjunctive orthodontics, enhancing the art of dentistry, a multidisciplinary viewpoint. So you all can, I have already shared the link in all the groups. Anybody who's not a part of the webinar groups, I request that you can please send me a message on my number. I'll be very happy to include all of you in that. So we have 5 more minutes to go, and so far on the portal I can see 68 people have registered for this webinar today, out of which 5 people are already logged in. And I'm sure as this goes, as we continue with the lecture, more people will be joining us. Am I audible to you all? If you could just write in the chat if I'm audible or not.
Yes. You're audible, sir.
Thank you, Prasad. So now, as we go on with this webinar series, which will be actually the part three will be the final webinar at the present moment. I am formulating a course in which there will be various modules, and it would be a 1 month to 2 months course, web-based, with so that everybody can, also if they cannot in time attend the webinar, a recording will be available on the site, which they can access. The only requirement would be to register with a username password on my website. The IT team is working on backend to finalize the things. Because of the shutdown, things are moving very slowly. It's not that people can't do the work sitting at home from IT, I don't understand, but then they are taking their own sweet time of making this backend login credentials on my website. So with that, if the meantime anybody who has attended the part two has any questions on part one or part two, we can answer this before other people can log in. I just want to appraise you a couple of things on practice management, that how I came across this topic. I myself struggled a lot, and I'm still struggling a lot in practice management. Primarily, what happens is that we all are professionals, and we are not carved out as businessmen. Also, in our dental curriculum, we have no exposure at all whatsoever on how to manage our practice. And as we get busy in our practice, as we get busy with seeing more patients, the things start going out of hand. So it's very difficult to manage a lot of things. And I have divided this practice management into five different aspects. And I don't call my webinar series as practice management, because we are just not managing a practice, but it's rather leveraging your practice, because we all are managing the practice. It's not that we may be subconscious about it, but we all are basically managing our practice. Now, the thing about managing the practice is how well we are managing. There must be certain things that everybody has evolved a system by which the practice is being managed. And one learns from experience of how all the various aspects of practice management are taken into consideration. So I like to call this topic more as leveraging your practice, because it's all about how you can enhance the management that you're already doing. Or if not, then you could structure the management in such a way that it is tangible. It is, you are getting regular reports. It is measurable, and we can also always get back to things which are not working and modify them. So these are the various things that one needs to consider. And it's 1 minute to five. We have around 15 participants now. We will start within 5 to 10 minutes. If anybody has a question right now, I would like to. Or we could do one thing before everybody logs in. If you can just unmute yourself one by one, I'll call out the name and you could just introduce yourself. It would be nice if everybody knows who's online. So starting with, so anybody can volunteer, unmute and speak. Or if you want, I can. Yeah, Nisar, you have unmuted yourself. So.
Yes, sir. I'm from DDU second year.
Nisar, please elaborate what is DDU second year. Nobody will understand.
Okay, sir. I'm from Dharamshri Desai, Faculty of Dental Science, Dharamshri Desai University. I'm studying in second year in dentistry, BDS, UG, undergraduate.
Welcome, Nisar, to the webinar.
Thank you, sir.
We have Dr. Sandeep, who has unmuted, Dr. Atul, Dr. Vijay.
Good evening, sir. This is Dr. Sandeep Chauhan, practicing orthodontics since last 10 years. I'm practicing in Delhi NCR.
Oh, that's very nice to know you, Sandeep.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome to the webinar.
My name is Dr. Atul.
So start video. Yes, Atul, please go ahead.
Sir, I am practicing ortho practice from last 5 years in Maharashtra, Kolhapur.
Oh, very good, very interesting. Welcome.
Hello, sir.
Yes, Dr. Srinivasa.
Hello, sir. This is Dr. Kalyan Srinivasa Arvind. I'm an orthodontist practicing since 11 years in Hyderabad.
Welcome to the webinar, Kalyana.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir. I'm a prosthodontist practicing in Pune since the past 5 years.
Hi, Anirudh. Anirudh is in himself an entity, and he, at a very young age, has attained lots of credentials to his credit. He is the key opinion leader for Sirona and for Ivoclare. And I know Anirudh personally. Is we very fondly called, he's my son-in-law because his wife is an orthodontist. So welcome, son-in-law.
Thank you, sir.
He manages a multi-speciality hospital in Pune, which is in one of its kind. And I learned a lot of things from Anirudh, and it's a pleasure to have you here, Anirudh.
Sir, it's my pleasure to be here and learn from you.
I just try my best. Okay, so Chintan, you wanted to introduce yourself?
Yeah, hello, sir. Chintan Shah, practicing in Ahmedabad since last 12 years.
Welcome, Chintan.
Thank you, sir.
Nice knowing you. Okay, now it's 5 ticking. And, yeah, Srinath, please go ahead, Srinath.
I'm practicing in Nellore, Andhra Pradesh, since last 21 years.
Wonderful. Dr. Prasad is there, no?
Yes, sir. I'm Dr. Prasad. I'm practicing orthodontist since 12 years, sir, in Bangalore.
Nice to know you, Prasad. Welcome to the webinar.
Yes, sir.
Now we have, slowly everybody is logging in. And so what we can do is I'll mute everybody and we'll start with the webinar now. We like to be on time so that we can finish it on time. If anybody wants to say in between, you can please unmute yourself and speak if you have any questions, or you could put the question in the chat box. I will start sharing the screen now. All right, so as you say that this is the part one of the Leveraging Your Practice series. I'm going to be a little fast here because we have lots of things to cover. There are two webinars combined into one webinar. So the first thing that I would like to tell all of you is, once again, let me reiterate that it's not that we don't manage our practice. So I personally feel if you are trying to teach a dentist practice management, it's a little a misnomer, because everybody has evolved in their own way and they are managing their practice. It's what we need to do is how to leverage that, how we can make use of this practice management. What structures can be there? So the first thing that everybody needs to do now there, you may have a practice probably with more than 5 to 10 years of experience. Your practice may be recent. You may have a one chair practice, two chair, three chair, to multiple chair practice. You may have one clinic to multiple clinics. You may be studying dentistry. You may have just passed dentistry and you are maybe trying to open up a practice. What I would like to very emphasize on a very key point is that whatever stage that you are, start afresh with practice protocols, as I will be discussing. A one chair practice or a person who has not started practice yet can also start with this management, because it's very important that from the very beginning you have the entire protocol and procedures in place. So when your practice grows, it exponentially grows, and your entire structure that you have evolved into your practice will get enhanced automatically. You will not be overwhelmed. When I started my practice, when I was seeing one patient, two patients, three patients a day, from which we slowly went off to seeing more than 70, 80 to 100 patients a day, it was very overwhelming for me because we don't know how to manage them. Those times were different. People were ready to wait 3 years in my waiting room. Today, nobody is willing to wait. And everybody needs to be seen. And they say that if you didn't have time, why did you appoint us? So now it becomes very imperative. And so we have now come down to the level where we have an average waiting time, which is around 15 minutes to 30 minutes, that patients do understand, because we are in a medical or a dental practice where everything doesn't go as planned. Unforeseen situations can also arise, and that is what we will be dealing with a little while later. So if you want to manage a practice efficiently and leverage it for your advantage, you need to do a self audit. What is a self audit? So what do you mean by an audit? We all have undergone an audit with financial audits. Maybe an income tax scrutiny, or maybe your chartered accountant may have, you know, audited your accounts, or accountant may be auditing your accounts. Here we are not talking of only financial audit. Usually the word audit is a synonymous with financial audit, but it's not. Audit means a self-appraisal of where do you stand. So I would like, the part one is basically on which five areas that you should see that you already have a system or a procedure in place. If not, then you have to start with that system and start putting it into your structure of your management of practice and how you can leverage it. So there are five important things that we need to understand. One is ownership. Second is marketing. Third is the operations. Fourth is finance. And fifth is people. Now, these are business terms, and these are not basically very inherent to dentistry or medical practice. A lot of people tell me that when you talk about the business of dentistry, you know, it's demeaning our profession. I do agree we should not call it a business per se, but at the end of the day, we are doing a business, aren't we? Maybe we are professionals, we are dignified, but we are not doing any charity work here. We are not doing anything for the benefit. I mean, it's not a philanthropic work that you are doing. At the end of the day, you have to pay your bills. You have to pay for yourself and your expenses. You need to buy a home. You need to pay for your child's education. You need to save enough money for your future. So all these things is basically, we are self-employed businessmen. So we need to understand that we have employed ourselves in our own business. There are businesses where the director or the owner, he is not overseeing everything. He is the owner, but there are other owners as well. At the same time, he is not in the production side, while we as dentists are on the production side. Because if you or me do not work in the clinic, right, the entire business is going to collapse. So that is why there is a little difference. And I do agree with a lot of dentists who say that it's not about business alone. Basically, we are, and that is the more reason why we need to understand and leave the other aspects of practice management other than production to other capable people whom you can prepare as your team member. Now, the second is marketing part. The marketing part, whether you like it or not, you need to market, and we all market ourselves, because we are not talking about advertising, okay? I'm not asking you to place an ad in a newspaper or on a web page or on online saying that, you know, you are the best dentist in town. You don't need to do that. But we are going to today talk about how you can utilize marketing, and more so how you can utilize free marketing. Because otherwise, you all know that the social media and other platforms online are very expensive if you want to reach. It all depends on how much and where do you want to reach. So, having said that, I can't hear, only video visible, any settings issue. Is anybody else having a problem with my audio?
No, all good.
No, sir. All good.
Dr. Akhil, you need to join. I don't know how we can help you in the audio, because from my side, everything is working. So maybe at your side, you need to settle down that issue. And we can't do that right now when the lecture is going on. Marketing is very, very crucial. You see, you may not realize, but now I'm telling you, I'm giving you a secret here. All right. You don't know what I'm actually marketing. When I'm talking to you, when I'm delivering this lecture, what am I doing? I am marketing my skills as a speaker. What will happen? I'm conducting free webinars. But you see, if I don't be very prudent and if I don't hit the message very clearly, I fail as marketing myself as a speaker. So there are certain inherent things when you are working on a patient, the patient is observing you. He or she is going to go out and is going to speak about you. Now, what he or she will speak about you is in your control, because you see, they have already made their presumptions and conclusions by getting treated or getting consulted in your practice. So we'll be discussing those inside marketing, which is also now known as HR marketing, as well as external marketing. Operations is not only about the dental treatment that we do or the dental procedures that we do or the consultations that we do. It encompasses everything. It encompasses sterilization, it encompasses, and I'm going to conduct a webinar on COVID ready dental clinics. I have done a lot of research, and I have now almost more than 100 PubMed index and Science Direct articles which I am reviewing right now on the challenges that dentistry is going to face post COVID. It's going to change the way we work. And here is a surprise for you all. It's going to change for the better. And I'm going to train you all for how you can actually take advantage of this situation in leveraging your practice. But that will be an entire topic. It will be updated in the webinar. I will be mostly doing it next week, because I still have to do a part three of this leveraging, as well as I have one or two clinical topics to cover. But this is an ongoing process, and I promise you that this is not going to stop even after the lockdown is lifted. We will mutually work out times. Maybe we cannot do it every day, but we will do it twice or thrice a week at a mutually convenient time for all practitioners. We must continuously update ourselves. I will tell you that the amount of information and the amount of knowledge that I have gained in the last 15 days of this lockdown is immense. I cannot thank my stars enough that I got so much time to look into things which I never thought I would be looking at. So operations primarily involves everything. And now you will have to consider the operations, because the operations are now going to become more important, because you are now going to have a better system in place for sterilization, for something known as infection prevention and control, which is IPC. Now, this infection prevention and control is going to be very critical in dentistry. And so now we need to change and we need to adapt to lots of operations. And I'm going to talk about the finance aspect. I will confess one thing to you all. I'm not very good at finance, but from whatever knowledge that I have of the finance, I will be talking on finance, which is a structured manner, how you can prepare a good financial structure in your practice, which will help you actually know how much you are worth. So audit is something of knowing what's your worth first. And then from there, we need to identify things where we lack. Of course, the people. Now, the people includes, you, your family, your social obligations, your patients, and last but not the least, the staff that you are working with. So we are going to talk a little bit about people and people management. Starting with ownership. You see, everybody and anybody who starts a business, be it a dental practice or be it a dental trigger business or be it a lab, we need to have a structured business plan. Now, what is a business plan? A business plan is that it all depends on two things: the quantum of business that you want to generate and the amount of investments that you're going to make, and what is a likely return on investment of the
investment that you're already making or you have made and you are not recovering enough money from your investment. A structured business plan of 3 years must be in place. If you don't have one, I can help you in preparing one offline on a one-to-one basis. We need to understand that we need to have a set targets, that this is the number of patients that I'm going to see. This is the way I'm going to charge my patients. These services are chargeable. Are they tangible? Are the charges comparative to the market? Am I being competitive enough? Secondly, what is the cash flow? How the money is going to get generated? And all that complete, you know, structure in a way that you know that end of 3 years, where you will be standing. You may not reach exactly, or you may overreach. It all depends. But you must understand that we need to be, even if we leave, you know, to meet somebody, if you don't know the address, we Google it up and put it on the map. We were not that fortunate enough in our time. We had to ask directions, but we still had a plan that this is how we are going to reach where we want to be after 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. The second important part about the ownership is that we all tend to become very dogmatic. I own a practice. I am the owner. I am the dentist. I own this practice. It is my way or the highway or get lost. Now, you see, before understanding this personality types, which are going to deal very in detail, you must understand that you are only owning a practice. You have invested money. All right. So one thing is, as a dentist, we have, like I previously said, we have two responsibilities. We are not only the owners, but we are the people who are producing the work, which is generating the revenue. So we have a dual responsibility. Now, if you are an owner, please understand my, and this is a secret I'm telling you, told to me by very senior people who have trained me, that before you enter the clinic, you must forget the idea that you own the practice. You go to your practice as if you are working there and not owning it. When you see, the entire perspective of looking at your practice will change. Not only looking at your practice, to your patients and to your employees, everything will change. Because now you are visiting, you are going to your practice as a working professional. Leave the other aspects, you know, to at other time, not during your clinical hours. During your clinical hours, you are the dentist, or specialized dentist, an endodontist, orthodontist. You are not the owner, because you, during your clinical hours, you must concentrate simply on working on your patients, because that is what is going to generate the revenue. You need to identify which area do you belong to. Are you extrovert? Are you introvert? Are you practical, or you are a dreamer, or you're a creative person? Now, you see, these personality traits will depend on what exactly output do you want. If you inherently have a personality trait, you have to leave certain other things to your staff. Now, that is what we will be talking about, identifying the leader a little while later. Iceberg spotting and contingency planning is like, you see, for example, what is a contingency plan? You are having a restorative practice and you use a lot of restorative material. So what will happen is that you are dependent on restorative material. So you always have a contingency plan that any given day, once you open up one restorative material, there is already one in place in the cupboard, so that what happens is that you never know when this is going to get over. So you have one surplus. So that is one of the contingency plan. You know, there is a contingency for everything. What if you do not get enough patients as you had planned for the day? What is the contingency? Right? You have a very important meeting for other profession, or maybe for some other work, maybe with a chartered accountant at 8 o'clock in the evening. What contingency plan do you have routinely that you finish your practice in time? Is it in place? Can you just instruct your staff at one thing and tell, look, I'm going to leave the clinic at 8 o'clock, race to manage. They will be able to manage it much better if you have a structural contingency plan, and that is known as a plan when you need to go from your clinic at a particular time. So these things, if they are put in proper place, they can be utilized to the benefit of your
utilization of not only of your manpower but of your time. The fourth thing, iceberg spotting. You all know about the Titanic, right? Titanic was called as unsinkable, and ironically, it sunk on its first maiden voyage. It hit an iceberg. So one of the, and now it's so serendipitous that you see we have hit an iceberg, haven't we? I think across the globe, dentistry has hit an iceberg, and we cannot practice dentistry. I don't think this has ever happened in the history of the recent history where dentists are not able to practice. Not only dentists, nobody is able to work. Who would have foreseen this situation? And those who foresaw this situation today, as we are talking, have become multi-billionaires because they have been capitalizing on the market share. For example, China. For example, a lot of stockbrokers and FII. They have disinvested at the right time and now they are purchasing all the stocks. So they have all this iceberg spotting. That what if the market hits? So there are triggers. Now, if you understand stocks and bonds and the debentures, you see what happens is that there is a trigger. When the market falls, there is something known as stop loss. So supposing you had purchased shares worth 10 lakhs and you have a stop loss on 9,90,000. That means the moment that share price touches 9,90,000, it automatically sells. So that is known as iceberg spotting. The markets are unpredictable. Even in dentistry, what is that threat that you may see tomorrow? I would like all of you to do this exercise. Right now, we have all the free time. And see what all threats we are going to face now that we have spotted the iceberg, that is COVID. How are we going to deal with it? This is the best time to also foresee other challenges which may happen to us tomorrow. 20 years back, when these dental colleges started growing, and just a minute, please, I need to... So what happens here is that, you know, we need to, I'm really sorry, I had to take a call in between, which was very urgent. So now here, what happens is that there may be situations 20 years back when the dental colleges started to increase in numbers. We need to understand that there was a time when we thought that now this will be a challenge tomorrow because now more number of dentists and specialists will pass out. And the number of dental clinics are bound to increase. I don't know how many of the senior people actually had, you know, had spotted this iceberg. But if they had spotted that iceberg at the right time, they would have salvaged. For example, me, I did not spot it in time. If you have, you know, a contingency, a second plan B, that what if there is a clinic, you know, which is in my own neighborhood, which automatically starts practicing and poses a direct challenge to me. If I have a plan in place, that this is how I'm going to counter it. Whether that thing has happened yet or not, that is not important. But this thing will happen tomorrow. And you preempt that situation and then you already have a plan. So whenever that situation happens, there's an auto trigger, which will also make you capable of handling that situation. You won't be in a surprise at that point of time. So that is known as iceberg spotting. Responsibility plan for self, family and social. You see, we all have responsibilities. Like I said when I began with this lecture, that we all have responsibilities for self, we have responsibilities for family. We also have responsibility for social welfare with the society. So you must have certain part of your business which is catering to that. Indian Orthodontic Society has come out with a program called Embrace. Now, what is Embrace? And that is a similar program known as Pro Bono by the American Association of Orthodontists, is that the number of cases that you do free per year. Are you doing work as charity? Are you trying to give back to the society what the society has already given you? This is the very important part that we have to understand. After ownership, we are discussing the marketing part. Now, the marketing we all know these days is that first thing that somebody will tell you is get a website, do search engine optimization, and get yourself visible on social media. Now, you see, a lot of people, including me, have spent a lot of money on all these aspects, but I think it's sheer waste of money unless you have a structure. So the main thing which I'm going to tell you very briefly, your website should reflect your practice. Your web designer should not be a person who is doing, a web designing book by book, page by page. They have this, format, and they will just design a website. They'll come and tell you, I already designed website for this doctor, that doctor. Well, that's not important. The most important thing is, does your web designer know what you want to be seen on your website? It's like a window, the whole world is going to look at it. Does it exactly reflect what are you trying to do? Your web designer doesn't know. Has your web designer visited your practice? Whatever a person is seeing at your website, he is forming an opinion. Now, if you have a structure in such a way that you have a click to action button wherein you get the user, the person who has clicked his contact ID, so that is known as generating leads. Now, when you are generating leads, there are organic leads and then there are paid leads. So there is a way you can measure that. But don't design a website for the sake of designing. Your website should reflect not only your practice, but also your ethos, your ethics, your way of working, the type of environment that you have, as well as it should reflect your personality. It should not, a patient, when he, after the lead generation from the website comes to your clinic, he is going to be in a shock if you have not portrayed. Now, I'm not talking about putting pictures of your clinic on website. No, that is like, it's a common sense that you're going to go place. But does the website as a whole reflect what you and your practice is? That is what I'm trying to tell you. Search engine optimization has no limit. You could spend 1,000 rupees to 10 lakhs to 1 crore on search engine optimization. It all depends on the number of clicks, the leads that you want to generate, and the reach that you want. Beginners should exercise caution before doing search engine optimization without having a plan or having a particular, when you have a particular plan. Say, for example, you want to generate implant cases. So your search engine optimization should be to that direction. You just don't simply, optimize your website. So there has to be like a target that this month, that's our target. So, it's called as power of one. What do you mean by power of one? Power of one means that you only do one thing the whole week or the whole month. You concentrate yourself that this month I am going to work on increasing my implant practice. Now that search engine optimization, branding, and other things will come into place. You see the wonderful results that you will get once you have enough control over what is it that you want to do. So you have this plan, and that is why you must have a structured business plan, like I said. We are going to come to in the part two when we discuss in detail about what business we are in. What do you mean by branding? The branding basically means that, are you being visible as a brand so that when they see your logo, for example, when they see your name, for example, does it reflect what you are? That is what branding means. Everything is uniform. You go to McDonald's at one place or you go to McDonald's around the world in another place. Both the McDonald's operate, everything is same, including this color scheme, the way they take the order, the way they process the order, the way they deliver the food, the billing, everything is same, right? There is Uncle McDonald sitting outside on a bench. So that is what branding is. If you are a brand, if Dr. Amish Mehta is a brand, that means, what it means is that that name itself is sufficient for everything else, right? If Dr. XYZ, when the name comes, people in your city already know that, okay, this means this. When you say Dr. XYZ means quality, means competence, means deliverance, means consistency. So this is the way that you generate your brand. Branding is very important it can also destroy you. Because if you have created a brand which actually is not what you are doing, you may end up having bad customers. What gets measured gets done is a very old saying. What gets measured gets done. We say that in BNI also. Measuring all your activities. What does it mean is that are you actually measuring that whatever efforts that you are making for marketing, which exercise is yielding what results? A lot of people come to me after spending so much money when I tell them, please give me the results. At least show me at least that if I spend 1,000 rupees on, for example, on Facebook, what did I get? Did I actually get any visibility? So they say, no, we can't guarantee that. No, that's not true. There is a way that you can, Facebook has, you know, a backend. You can download that app called Facebook Ads. Not only Facebook Ads, even YouTube, everything has a separate app which you can download and see your activity. Even if you don't promote it, you can still see the activity. Organic. Some people, a celebrity, you know, he doesn't need to actually optimize his social media. It goes on its own. But somebody is measuring what is happening. What posts are creating more likes? What posts are creating more following? So all these things you need to measure. Again, whosoever is doing your marketing has to give you a report. That, okay, this week we did this, we targeted this for this particular population or this particular geographical area. This was the age group. This was the keywords that we put in, right? If you're an orthodontist, this is the time, not this time as COVID times, but the vacations are the time when the kids go in for braces. The parents usually look for orthodontists. So this April, May, June are the time that you should try to increase your orthodontic practice. So you need to reach that people. Now, what are the likes? What are the dislikes? Social media measures everything. And you can actually, you know, structure your campaign in such a way that it actually reaches to the people whom you want it to reach, which is one of the target audience. So which is your target? Where exactly do you want to target? For example, Invisalign or any clear aligners is an expensive treatment, right? So there are two types of people who spend money. One who has enough money to spend and another person who will save money and will spend on a better treatment. Now, these are the best people who save money because they know the value. The people who are throwing money here and there are not very compliant patients. But anyways, you need them for your practice. So you need to target them. So for example, a high net worth individual, which not very called as an HNI. So what are the things that the HNI likes? Which are the pages that he or she visits more often? You have to target those areas when you are starting a campaign. You may have a media manager for yourself, but I'm just giving you these tips and I can't go into too much of details, but this is the way thing. And please have a system where you get reports. You can also generate your own systems where you regularly get reports for your marketing exercises. Operations. Now, operations is one part that is the treatment that you render. The scope of this lecture is not to teach dentistry of how you should perform on a patient. The primary thing is to tell you that operations, as in the operations on the patient, is only one part of the operation. You know, you may have equipment, you may have IT, you may have computers, you have certain procedures and systems, there are certain way that you work. For example, what is the protocol in your practice when a patient calls for the first time? So is every time that a person calls, is he or she greeted the same way by everybody who picks up the call? So that is known as procedurization. That if you call Chandan Dental, this is what the person will hear. Now that is also a part of your branding, but also a part of your practice management because it provides consistency. Do you have a procedure known as, for example, a follow-up, which we call as a recall? Or maybe sometimes we do an all-well call. Next day, we have performed a lot of procedures. The next day, there is a system in our practice that the patient gets a call from our own side by the treating doctor itself of how he or she is feeling. Does she or she have a question? So this is a procedure and system which is in place. You, a very favorite topic of mine is about the tray setup. You see, I am going to take a lecture on tray setup later on in the continuation of practice management in the part 3. What is tray setup? You see, you are performing, let's say, 15 procedures. Okay, there are 15 procedures that you practice in your that you do in your practice. Do you have a tray setup for each procedure? Does your staff know that what exactly instruments are required? So what you should do is that if you don't have one, identify all those 15, 20 procedures that you are performing in your practice. Okay, write it down, prepare an Excel sheet. Then when you're performing it, okay, at the end of the performance, end of the treatment, take a picture of the tray. Okay, it will be very unorganized, it will be dirty, but take a picture of that tray, then pick up all the instruments, clean it, and then put it in the chronological order, the equipment which was used first, second, third, right? And then take a picture again. Give it to your staff and say that, tell them that the next time I'm performing this procedure, my tray should look like this. A picture tells 1,000 words. So this is what you mean by procedures and systems. In my part two, when we come, I'm going to talk in detail about the role maps. What exactly a role map is? Is a structure of your organization. What are the various roles that each person plays? No, it's not person dependent. It is role dependent. You may be one person in your practice. That means you are filling up all the roles in your map. Now, once you have all your name in almost every block or the box in the role map, or your assistant, you have a one assistant, the other things you are doing, as your practice goes, you need to exit yourself from the other boxes and you need to fill it up with other people. That is what we are going to talk in part two. So that role maps are very important. Do you have a customer relationship management system in place or not? This is very important these days. Customer relationship. It's a CRM, it's a full form. Some of you may say that patients, not customers. Okay, then call it PRM. But I'm just talking on business language. So it is customer relation. We have CRM system. And there is another thing which is also known as ERP, which is enterprise resource planning. These both the things must be there in your practice, which is a part of your operations. Customer relationship, if you don't have a customer relationship software, which is tracking automatically of how your patients are doing and how they talk about you, how they speak about you, are you communicating to them on a, you know, on a periodic level? Because when we shut down on a major way, our hospital, when we are working only for emergencies, each of my patients got an SMS on their mobile saying that, you know, we are open only for emergencies and we are solved. So this is what I'm talking about. Do you have a rescheduling procedure in place? Do you try to cultivate a cordial or a relationship with your patient who can be a leader, you know, in terms of bringing you patients? So you need to identify that one particular patient. The power of word of mouth should not be undermined at any point, any juncture of your career, maybe 2 years or 20 years. The word of mouth publicity will be the greatest when you have an excellent CRM in place. Customer service, that is like what service you are providing to the patient. It's not about what you do alone, okay? You may be doing the best dental treatment possible, but how you are doing it, see? How you are doing it, it's very important. I'll give you one example. Like, you see, there is one way of excising an ameloblastoma, for example. And that one way is that it has to be excised in toto. So what happens is that the end of the procedure, that entire lesion has to be in one piece in the surgical tray. So when during my BDS days, we were invited into OT where one of our teacher was actually excising an ameloblastoma. And when the senior professor came and he saw that the ameloblastoma, the site was looking perfect. But when he saw the tray, he saw multiple pieces of the ameloblastoma and he just banged his head. You know what happens when you do that? That because that is a high incidence, it is documented in literature that when you don't excise ameloblastoma in toto at one go, it's going to relapse. So that is what we are trying to say here, is that whatever you do, it's not about what we do, but how we do. How are we supposed to do it? You may be doing the best restoration in town, but how are you doing it? That is very important in customer service. Do you have enough disposables? Is the patient comfortable? Is the patient being completely appraised
of what you are going to do in very layman terms, as if like, you know, very simple terms. Don't use complicated words and complicated treatment procedures. Try to talk to the patient in as simple language as possible. Avoid words using, I will have to evaluate your case for a better outcome of the treatment. You just say that I need to study. I need to have a deeper look into your case. Okay, that's it. You don't have to say, a lot of people use very complicated words. You've got chronic, you know, periodontitis, for example. So that patient will feel that it's a very great thing. And there is a WhatsApp joke also going about pericoronitis, and you all must be aware of it. Because, but you know, the pericoronitis is what actually is inflammation of the soft tissue surrounding a tooth. And that is known as pericoronitis. But now this coronitis, corona, has given an entirely different angle. So that is what the importance of talking in layman terms. You don't have to tell the patient that you have got this disease. As long as you tell him in the layman terms, he or she will be at more risk. Now, of course, the person has a malignancy, you have to somehow break that news and you need to tell them. But I'm talking of simple things, okay? So pulpitis, you can always say that the inner portion of your tooth, which is supplying the blood and is innervated, is infected. That's it. When you use the word pulpitis, he thinks that something very big has happened. So this way you can, so this is known as customer service. Templates is about having templates of everything. You already know what is a template. Template is a fixed flow chart. You know that this is the particular way. For example, I will share with you a couple of templates that we have for our practice later on in the part three. Is what does template mean is that there is a structure. There is a complete, now if you have seen this COVID, now there are algorithms that they have created, you know, algorithm one, algorithm two, algorithm three. There are three algorithms on which emergency cases can be seen in this COVID times. And there is a template, there is a structure, there is a questionnaire. If there is a yes to this question, then you go on a different line. If there is a no, then you go on a different line. So you have a template, for example, tray setup template. What do you mean by tray setup template? For example, the assistant has the list of all the appointed patients for the next day and the procedures are written. So now the template is such that the assistant has a template of tray setup is number one, he has to identify the procedures. After identify the procedures, it goes next is that what is the tray setup for that procedure? Then the next step would be he has to look at the picture and the list of the equipment or the instruments not only ready, but they should be sterilized, pre-packed with the patient's name on it. This is one thing is internal marketing. When you bring that tray in front of the patient, which is wrapped, which is completely sealed, and with his or her name on it, has a different impact altogether. So that is what I mean to say. It's not about what you do, why you do, it is how you do. It's very important. Everybody talks, right? Everybody talks. Tell me one person who is capable of talking and is not talking. But still, you see, some people are impressive, some people are not impressive, some people when they talk, you don't want to hear them, some people when they talk, you want to keep hearing. So it is how they talk is more important than what and why they talk. So the presentation part, the soft skills that you have, these all things matter a lot. The fourth thing is accounts. Again, whether you have enough systems in place or not. Are you measuring what you are earning? What you are spending? Do you know how much profit you are making at the end of the day? Do you have an ordering process? For example, most of the dentists in my times, even today, if I know, it's everything is ordered on the telephone. You just place a call, send me this restoration, and we'll see. You see, please beware. I'm not trying to demean the dental traders here, but there is a iceberg spotting here that you see a trader can be dishonest with you when you are doing, ordering process on telephone without keeping a track. So it's very simple. Have a purchase order. It doesn't take much to prepare a purchase order. What does purchase order mean is that what is it exactly that you want? What is the quantity that you want? What do you want? What is for example, these bottles are available in small, medium, whatever type. So it should be very crystal clear mentioned in it with the price mentioned inclusive of taxes. That is, you already negotiated the price, you are only processing the purchase order. So when the dealer gets that written purchase order or you send him by mail, he or she has to process it. When it comes back to you, when the order is actually processed and when you receive the material, whether you received it in order or not,
You have a copy of that purchase order, right? So you need to stamp on it that the goods received in good condition. Goods received in bad condition. Bad condition means you have to send it back. So all these things have to be measured. So that is what you mean by an ordering process. Again, inventory maintenance. Does the ordering process automatically trigger the moment there is a particular quantity of the material in your clinic? It reaches a level where you have only one thing left. For example, a packet of gloves. You should not be in a surprise that tomorrow your assistant comes and tells you, sir, the gloves have got over. I forgot to order. So there has to be a triggering mechanism. Automatically, that ordering process starts. When there is one box, you have to order another box. You don't wait. When the last packet is opened, it has to be ordered. Not after, after half or maybe most of the last packet of the material that you utilized is already finished. See, we all do this mistake. Even I do this mistake of the payable process. Are we paying people in time? We must have a schedule. Like we only make payments on the 1st of the month or the 15th of the month or the 25th day of the month. But you must be aware of how much money you owe to whom. That entire Excel sheet should be readily available with you. You should know that this is what I owe to people. So now, supposing you owe 10 lakhs rupees and you don't have money in your bank. So what happens now? You need to generate that revenue somehow in the next 3 months. So that again comes and it gets triggered into the marketing part, which is that area which is generating maximum revenue for you, which is the most profitable treatment in your practice. Target that, because that will generate the most profitable, most revenue earning procedures need to trigger when you have lots of outstanding. It goes without saying. So this is how you can start, whether you are alone in your clinic, two people or 100 people in your clinic. Start with this exercise right from the beginning at whatever stage of practice that you are in. You will not end up having lots of struggle and traders calling, give me money, because you already started that process, that marketing is going on, the patients are coming in. But having said that, you see, you have to be competent clinically. Right, the clinical competence in leveraging your practice is taken for granted. If you are not clinically competent, and if you are a good businessman, employ the best dentist or the best specialist in your practice. Employ him at a higher cost. No, he will not going to go anywhere. If you have a system in place, a lot of people ask me, sir, how to retain the good people? Okay, so we are going to talk in the people management. Payable process, like I said, now the invoicing and collections is very important. You see, whether you are generating invoice for each work that you are doing or not, and whether that each invoice is paid or not. This is the best way to keep track whether your patients are paying you money or not. Otherwise, how will you remember how many procedures you have done in a day, in a week, in a month? You cannot keep a track of that. So what you need to do is that you need to invoice each and every procedure that you do. Has to be invoiced. Now, how it can be invoiced? It can be invoiced many ways. For example, all of you know that if you have gone to, not in these times, now there is all computer and everything is tracked accordingly. There are barcodes which are scanned, which can also be incorporated into your practice. We can talk at length about it. But in old times, when there were no computers, whenever you buy a shirt from a big shop, what they will do is they have a triplet book. That means that anything that they write, there are always original and two more copies. They tear the first page and give it to the customer and tell them to collect the shirt that you have purchased from the counter after paying the money. And the second slip goes to the counter. So when the first slip and the second slip matches and when it is paid, the goods are given. But the person who has actually given the shirt has the final copy. At the end of the day, both of them are matched. Whether each invoice that was generated at the place or the site of generating the service and at the site where it is being paid. It could be the same. You may be collecting the money or your staff is collecting the money. But at the end of the day, you must have a track record. I did these 10 procedures. This is the proof that I have done the 10 procedures. This is the payment process. This is the 10 duplicates which went to the reception. At the end of the day, whatever invoices that you generated manually, I'm talking manually, you can purchase a triplet. You don't need a computer to do that. What I would advise each of you is start manually and then slowly digitize it. That way what will happen is that you know now. You see, digitization is not going to solve your problem. Because what has happened with digitization is that it is what we are already doing has been digitized. Simply digitizing your practice without understanding is not going to help you. So you have to understand that what exactly the digital platform is going to perform for you. So that is invoicing and collection. Again, the template should be there for everything in accounts. There are templates, there are flowcharts, that this is how the procedure is done. An invoice is generated, a duplicate is given. The original is given to the patient, the duplicate goes to the reception, the triplicate remains with the dentist on the chair he or she is performing. If you have a multi-chair practice, end of the day, bring all the books together, bring all the paid invoices, unpaid invoices, next day automatically triggers phone calls. You have this much amount due to us, please come and pay. You can send them a PayPal link or a Razor, or you can give them your online account number. There are multiple ways of online payment which the patient can do. He or she has not paid for your service. Believe me, once you start tracking, you will be surprised that how many patients actually still owe money to you. And it happens. We are too busy with our own practice. Sometimes we forget. So that happens. And so if it is measured, if it is written, that is going to help you a lot. Again, the report should come to you on daily, weekly, monthly. Your daily collection report, for example, that this is the amount of money. Procedure-wise, patient-wise, it has to be there on your table. So you know how much money you want. Weekly also, you can have a structure that how much money did you spend, for example. What all was ordered this month. So you now know can keep a track on all the expenses that you have. Now the most important is the people, that is the workflow. Now the management of workforce starts not after you hire, it starts before you hire. So you must have a specific hiring process. You must know what kind of person do you need. If you need a dental assistant, his personality trait should be like this according to my work pressure. You must have that idea very clearly. After you hire, try to retain that person. How to hire is also very important. There are lots of books which tell you how to hire. There are a lot of CEOs who are giving online lectures of the proper hiring procedure. Just don't hire somebody out of sympathy, please. Just because some relative of yours is not doing well in his life, don't employ him in your practice. It is better to give him money. Do the charity. But don't let that charity destroy your business. I have undergone all these mistakes, so I am reflecting that. Just because somebody needs a job doesn't mean that you give him a job, right? Why don't you employ, if you feel that somebody needs a job and if you identify him as a person who can be very detrimental to your practice, please send him to your competitor. Okay, that's on a lighter mode. What you do is that hire the best people. You see, sympathy, compassion, philanthropy, all this comes outside your practice. Okay, forget all those things when you are in your practice. You can do enough charity from the money that you earn, but don't do it at the cost of your own practice. Every employee that you have, should be having. Just a minute, what happened here? Okay, every employee that you have, information should be there, be it one employee, 10 employees, or 100 employees. That should be one file for each employee, okay, in which there is a copy of his Aadhaar card, a copy of his PAN card, a copy, a photograph, identity proof, his bank account details, his details of his family, how many children does he have, what are they doing. That's all very important. That entire information of every staff of yours should be there in the file, and it should be easily retrievable. Because if that staff tomorrow goes away and you don't have any identification, it can be a problem. Again, it's a good HR system by knowing the family members of your staff, for example. If it belongs, that my boss cares for my family as well. There should be a sound staff review system. Your staff should regularly get reviewed by your patients as well as by each other. We have a staff review system wherein every week, each staff gives a review on certain traits of other staff, and it is all sum total, and we keep it in his or her file. The moment he or she has performed a very good job, it is written down in his file, and it is written that on this particular day, because of this staff, this it saved the day, and we go undergo all these things. So you can't remember at the end of the day if he or she has done something awfully wrong. Please document it. You should know when he or she tries to threaten you. You have 10 things that can be used against him, saying that, see, these are the mistakes that you're making in one single month. You can go and review your staff, which staff to retain, which staff to kick out. Please believe me, there is a very famous saying that companies don't become a failure because they fail to hire. Companies become a failure because they fail to fire. So that is very important for all of you to understand that you must, as the hiring process is important, you should also know when to fire somebody and kick them out. He can be a biggest liability to your practice. Apparently, he or she may be very good, but when you have a system in place, you will realize that actually he or she, or probably that staff is not fit for this job, but he may be fit for the other job. You can always shift him to that department. All right. If he doesn't want to be shifted, well, tell him, God bless you, because you are not fit for this one particular job. This is what your review system and your HR profile is showing us. Work culture. There has to be a work culture. You see, there is a particular way everybody talks. There is a particular way that everybody looks. There is a particular way that everybody is groomed. There has to be uniformity. All your assistants should be groomed the same way. All your doctors should be groomed the same way. All your doctors should be talking the same way. All your assistants should be communicating the same way. These work cultures has to be placed in written, and it should be easily retrievable and accessible for all employees in the language that they understand. I may write a very nice work culture in English, and 90% of my staff doesn't understand English. It is all, you know, then what use is it for them? So you must have in their own vernacular language the entire work culture rules in place. Another thing is voice is not clear. That was long back anyway. Is my voice clear? Can somebody tell me whether the voice is clear or not? All right.
Very clear, sir.
Right, yes, sir.
All right, thank you so much. So now, as we are talking more on the work culture, now see, for example, let's say nowadays you must be getting lots of, you know, do's and don'ts of a Zoom webinar. That's a work culture. They say that if you are not properly groomed, please shut the video off, right? So that's a culture of a Zoom webinar. It is always prudent for every person who is listening to switch off the mute and switch off the video, because that is the most important part about the entire process. So these are the work cultures. You see, your waiting room should reflect, you know, it should not look like a mess. There has to be a culture. There has to be for example, the quality of the magazines that you put in your waiting room. It should reflect your culture, right? You can't have a scandally clad, heroine's front page film magazine in your waiting room if you are into a very serious business, you see. So, you know, the selection of magazine also reflects your, you put more health magazines, you put more professional magazines, right? I have a major orthodontic practice. So we put this, Champak and Twinkle, you know, the children love it. You need to, because you are reflecting an ethos that you have. Lots of coffee table books are there, which reflects my thought processes. All right. So the patient understands. These days, they are very smart. Just as we all have become smarter, so have the patient. When we go to some place, you know, we do an audit of that place. So do our patients. So now we need to understand that. Staff performance report, what do you mean a staff performance report? Now, staff performance report, something which is to be auto-generated. And that performance report is, again, there is a HR person, or they report each other. And for example, housekeeping, for example, sterilization process. So how well or bad is your staff performing in that particular area? So those reports should be available to you. You may adopt a system. I can help you in adopting a system where you get a report on the how many sterilization cycles, for example, were autoclaved, how many times it was done, whether it was done properly or not. Are we doing, I skipped the topic staff development. I will talk after I finish staff performance report. Thank you, Vijay, for that update. So when we are talking about you have something known as a swab analysis. Now it will become very imperative in our clinics to have a swab analysis, because swab analysis will actually tell you what all microorganisms your clinic is actually harboring. It's so important for us to know. So this kind of things will come, and that is where the staff, you as a dentist cannot do a swab. The swab has to be taken by your assistant. That proper system has to be in place. Monday morning, 9 o'clock, the swab is taken, given to the laboratory. Once the report comes, we exactly know. Now, we know there are microorganisms. So do what? So that also should get triggered, that we should have ozonization or fumigation in place. And now you see these, all these things will become very important once we reopen. We have already started preparing ourselves and trying to find vendors for it. You also please start doing that. I'll be, once I have completely revamped my clinic, I will be talking in detail about how you can now make yourself more, you know, appear more confident to your patients that, okay, you go to this place, we are not going to get any COVID. It's very important. People are now going to ask you that, how are you going to ensure us that we don't get the disease? So this goes. You will have to have something in place which is tangible, which is measurable, which is visible. Okay. Staff development programs is simple, very simple. You see, a lot of these companies do it. For example, Iboclair, for example, Sirona, for example, PlanMeca. A lot of these big companies, you know, their trainer comes to your practice and he trains your staff. That you see, for example, GC, for example. When you buy their amalgamator, you know, and you buy their glass ionomer, which comes with the mixture, the staff actually comes and trains. So you could have specific days wherein the representatives of the company can come and train your assistant staffs, and you also get trained of how to use this product. For example, the user's manual. How many times do we actually open up the instructions of use? Because we don't open up and then we blame the product. We have not followed the proper procedure. How to maintain a particular equipment. So all this training can be developed. So these are the hard skills that needs to be trained. Another are the soft skills. So for example, you see, if your staff is, most of our staff comes from a lower economic background, it's very difficult to make them understand the importance of greeting, of having a smile, because they will come and live in your practice just the way they are living in their house and neighborhood. That is their culture. So you need to have somebody who trains them. See, telling somebody to do something, ordering somebody to do something is entirely different from making a person understand why he has to do it. Once he or she understands how to do it, why to do it, then he or she is better likely to follow the instructions. So in staff development programs, we usually have a soft skill trainer. We also have personality development trainers. Everybody coming in biannually to our practice. We have sessions where the staff has to attend it. After that, there is also a test which is given to them in the language. So we come to know exactly how much they have actually understood. So these are all the measurable activities. Doing staff development programs and then not measuring the outcome or not measuring whether actually they have got developed or not, then the whole exercise is futile. So I hope that suffices with this. Almost at the end of my part one of my webinar. We are 1 hour into the webinar, and I have to finish lots of other topics. So now you see, the next thing is, which I will try to tell you, is identify the 7 human needs. So basically, any human being on an average with an increasing or decreasing intensity has these 7 human needs. Okay, certainty, variety, connection, significance, growth, contribution, and meaning. What do you mean by certainty? You know, like there are certain people who are perfectionists. They will not accept things unless it is done in a particular way, whether it is right or whether it is wrong. They have to be certain that you are going to extract my teeth in this particular way. Now his need is certainty. If you identify that need and if you cater to it, he or she is more likely to get connected to you, be it your staff or be it your patient. A variety. Now, for example, we all have this variety. Don't we get fed up of the same food every day? Because it is a human need to have variety. We get fed up sitting at one place. That is what is happening these days. That is why you all are here, because you want to do something different. Now, we just don't want to sit home. See, if I'm not wrong, my mother told me that these days the domestic violence has actually increased. Can everybody please mute? Okay, fire muted. You see, the domestic violence, I mean, in India. Who is still killing this?
I'm sorry, I have to mute everybody. Now, if you want to speak something, please
raise your voice.
My voice is not clear? Hello, is it clear now? Hello, is my voice clear? Can somebody tell me whether the voice is clear or not? Maybe there is some internet issues. I'll try to change the Wi-Fi. All of you, please stay. Hello, everybody. Is my voice clear? Is my voice clear, please? Can you all hear me, please? Hello?
Yes.
Okay, so you can hear. Okay. I'm so sorry, I have to mute everybody again. Okay, fine. Okay. Dr. Anju, you have raised your hand. Do you want to say something?
Your voice is clear.
Thank you so much, Anju. Okay, so can I lower? Okay. So now, the one more thing is, now you see, when we have variety, what do you mean by variety? The variety means that everybody loves, we are sick and tired right now, sitting at home and doing nothing, for example. There's the same routine life. You get up in the morning, you just look at the news and the same news are coming, and a lot of people are now exiting the WhatsApp group, you know. Because the same messages are coming. There is no variety. Your mind becomes, you know, blocked. So that is why, you know, we look forward to the Sunday, because Monday to Saturday routine, now we need variety. This need is a human need. So does your patient and your staff requires this need. There has to be a break, okay? Your patient may have a need of a variety, you know. For example, you see, most of my cases which comes for clear aligners, you know, these are the people who are very high need of variety, because they don't want conventional braces. They would spend more money simply because it's different. They don't want to undergo that. No, everybody else is doing it. I want variety. That is why some people like some type of food. Some people do not like some kind of food. Some people need a connection, right? Okay, I will not deal with you unless I feel connected with you. How many times you have come across people like this, right? They will initially come across as very tough people, you know. They have a shell around them, and they will be like, you know, you just can't break through. But once you're connected with them, you all of a sudden open up, because their need of connection is now settled. So how well do you connect with your patient? You see, you can find out, you know, the likes and dislikes, the habits of the person, and then you can always have, you know, a connection with your patient. There may be some people who do not like to get connected. Don't waste your time there. But unnecessarily, they will speak, you know. They will say, doctor, baat bahut karta hai yaar. Kaam kam karta hai. That kind of a person is more of a need of a certainty. Maybe he's a need of significance, but he doesn't need a connection. You do my job, I go home, I pay you money, that's it. I am not interested in connection. So a person who doesn't have connection as a need, you don't need to be over-friendly with that person, because he can become detrimental. Some people like significance, okay? Unless I am not being called in this particular way, I am not going to come. You know, you send out invites for a party, you know, and some people will say that I didn't come because I was not invited properly. Now, you say that, what do you mean by a proper invitation, you know? So that person needs a significant. He needs to be like felt significant enough to come to your place. So your patient will not visit you. If he or she feels a doctor, then it's very hard. He's not looking at me at all. He's not giving me enough attention. He's talking to other people. That is why, you know, I always say one thing, that don't speak on telephone, don't speak to other people while you're working on the patient, because significance need of a dental patient while on the dental chair increases. He wants that the doctor should concentrate on my work, and then he feels significant and he's silent.
right? So please ensure that that privacy is there. Now, some people, unless they don't grow, you know, like they are, it's also a little need which is attached to variety. I am not happy by earning 1 lakh rupees a month. I need that growth. I am not happy seeing 5 patients a day. I need growth. I am not happy with this information and knowledge that I have. I need growth. So these need, if you identify that need, especially with your staff retention will increase. Because that particular staff, you are identifying, you are paying him well, you are giving him enough significance, you are giving him variety, you are giving him breaks, you are very well connected with him. But sometimes, you know, that staff just goes away. Why? Because he feels he or she is not growing here. यार इधर एक का एक काम करने का कुछ नया आ, मेरा कुछ करियर तो बढ़ी नहीं रहा especially with the dentists in your practice. In your previous 2 webinars, this most common question that was asked to me was how to retain good dental consultants in our practice, right? So if you identify, if that person is wanting growth, you know, give him that growth, give him that avenue where he feels that he is growing in your practice. That patient also should feel that, no, if I go here, it's not only that my problem is solved, but doctor has actually told me 5 other things which I should have known for my dental health care. Now he has grown in his knowledge. That need for growth is taken care of. There are some people, believe me, there are good people in this world. I mean, everybody is good in this world. But unless they don't feel that they are contributing, they will feel a little inferior. There must be in your family, there will be in your patients, and there will be in your staff. They need to be catered to have felt that they are contributing. I am giving something. Not only giving, which is sensible, tangible. And he feels good about it. That is why some people do a lot of social work. Because contribution is their need. They need to contribute. A lot of people, you know, donate a lot of money because they get satisfied. I don't have enough money. I will go out and do social work because my contribution need. So a patient, if he or she's contribution is a need, make him refer you patients. Okay, tell him that, you know, you are the best person who can let me, talk about us. He will feel very good. Wow, I'm contributing to Dr. Amish Mehta's practice. My need is satisfied. I'll be very happy with Dr. Amish Mehta. So this is how that thing. Now, meaning, you know, so there are some people who try to find out what is the meaning of doing this. Why? What is the meaning of getting braces done? Why? So they need to be told the reason. Now, if you do not tell them the reason, and if you cater to their certainty, theek ho jayega ekdam, tera problem. But he doesn't want to know whether theek ho jayega ka nahi. Usko to ye janna hai ki kyun theek ho jana chahiye. Now, that is a very difficult question to answer. But you have to answer, boss, see, if you don't treat your dental caries at this stage, you might end up with an extraction or root canal and a crown. And you have to pay me 10 times more money than what you are actually going to pay me by a simple restoration. So meaning is the need, then he or she is going to get onto it immediately. So if try to find out these 7 human needs of everybody, and your life will become very easy. Hire, train, and retain. Nothing but the best. All right, so that's very important. If you feel that you have the best people with you, try to retain them. Okay, by catering to one of those 7 needs. Now, this is a very interesting topic. All of us have dental assistants, and we tell them, go and get this instrument, which we did, 3 days back, we did a restoration. Usme nahi wo ek instrument bahut acha kaam mein laga tha. To fir maine usko pe laga, uspe thoda sa aisa jang laga hai, lekin fir hum usko polish karke usko karaya tha humne. You know, gold plating करा के तो वो instrument लेके आ जा. So that person, if he's an inferential listener, he will get it because now he's inferring from what you are talking. But a non-inferential listener, who is a literal listener, wants to know the name of the instrument and from where to get it. He is not going to take any clue. So sometimes a person does not understand an explanation, but a person understands an order. So an explanation. A person who understands an explanation is an inferential listener because he will infer from what you are talking and he will understand and he will do it. But there are some people who want a literal instruction. This is what you need to do. Now, in our dental practice, please have, whether the person is literal listener or an inferential listener, number one thing, give him a written instruction, which is literal. Okay? A written instruction, which is literal. He or she is less likely to underperform. So this is very important. The communication is very, very important. If I am, tomorrow I'm going to deliver a lecture on adjunctive orthodontics. I'm going to speak for Colgate tomorrow at 12 o'clock. Anybody wants a link, it's there in the webinar group. I will again post it tonight or tomorrow morning. It's a Google Meet. If there are more participants, the participant limit is 250. The Colgate might reorganize or a retake of the lecture. But I have given certain instructions to my staff, which is in writing, that I need this kind of cases, which is a complete list. So I go to my Dolphin software and I retrieve all the images in the PowerPoint presentation, and it's all done. Return instructions sent to him over. We use an app called Slack. And we also have a WhatsApp group, but WhatsApp group, clutters everything. There is one group, 20 people. How are you going to keep a track? Who said when, what? So these apps called Slack. There is another app for which I am a brand ambassador. It's known as Highlight. And the owner of Highlight is a very good friend of mine. And if you want to download it, just Google it up. Go to your Play Store or App Store and just download an app called Slack. I will write here in the chat box here. To everyone, send me the link. I am actually, I will post all this in the WhatsApp groups, but there is a Slack app called Slack, which can be used. Slack requires a little bit of training, but I am there always. I am there at the touch of your button. You can call me or message me. These days, I want to contribute a lot to the society. And another app is called Highlight. So there are many apps actually which you can use for communication with your staff, and there are various channels, topics, everything is different. Okay, we can take a separate lecture altogether on how to utilize these apps for internal communication with your staff members. This has got nothing to do with your patient. So it is a written communication which is tracked, which can be, you can send, for example, files, you can send pictures, IOPS to your consultants. They are there on the app. You have a channel of, let's say, all oral surgical procedures. You have a separate channel. Only the oral surgeons, you and some administrative staff are there in that particular channel. And whatever you want to share, including the photographs and everything, you can have a subheading, you can have different threads, and it's amazing. Both Slack and Highlight, they work like crazy and have immensely helped me in my practice in managing. So communications, I'm very clear. You see, inferential listeners are people who infer. Are the people whom we leave every day and are living with us for years, right? You don't even have to talk, just a look, they look at you. You go home and your child looks at you and says, dad is very angry today, right? He has already inferred without you uttering a single word, just looking at your face. Similarly, your staff also. So my advice to all of you, one thing which I have, after following that, life has become very easy for me. If you are in a bad mood, don't enter your house or your clinic, period. Sit in the car in the parking lot. Listen to a nice music. Don't go with a bad mood to your house or to your clinic. All right? Have a beautiful time. Spend something which you like and then enter your house and see how it changes your personal and professional life. This is one thing which we talk about, the personality traits of people. And now here what we have is that if you can see this chart, there are 8 paths. These are also known as the 8 paths of personality. On the extremes of the 4 paths, there is extroverted personality, there is introverted personality, there is creative personality, and there is a practical personality. So person who is creative and is extroverted, for example, Amitabh Bachchan, Shah Rukh Khan, Tom Hanks, and all the film stars, they all are extroverted people. They love to talk, they love to present themselves, and they are very creative. They are artists. They can talk, they can act, they can actually cry without having to go to cry. They are creative. They are not practical that I will only cry when I have to cry, because it's impractical to cry when you don't have to cry. You can't become an actor, right? A practical person is, unless my rules and regulations are like this, and I will not budge to it. He's a very principle-minded person, but he is extroverted. All right. So, but those kind of people are very good negotiators. They are very good, they can be very good people who market yourself. These are the people who can negotiate. These are the people who can actually, make anybody understand the viewpoint. So these are the people that should you have in your practice. If you are not one, hire somebody who is one. Then we go a little down on the practical side, and the introverted side is a collector. We call the deep waters, the deep waters. There are also the silent waters. Some people are silent, but they are very deep. राइट. सो हिंदी में बोलते हैं शांत पानी. तो वो लोग जो है वो बहुत ही इंट्रोवर्टेड है. फॉर एग्जाम्पल वॉरेन बुफे, यू डोंट हियर वॉरेन बुफे, राइट? ही डजंट क्रिएट वीडियोस एंड टॉक्स, राइट? ही इज सिंपली एमेसिंग वेल्थ बिकॉज ही इज इंट्रोवर्टेड. इज वेरी प्रैक्टिकल, ही नोज टू डू व्हेन व्हाट. ही डजंट डिसरिस्पेक्ट हिज ओन ethics, ethos of working, and there is a set way that he does work, and so he doesn't fail. He's a very good collector. Okay, the architects, for example, a lot of dentists, they don't talk much, but they do beautiful work, right? So these are the people who are actually on this side. Now they will not be good at marketing. They have a very good practice. They do very good work, but yet they are not exactly. There's nobody. They cannot speak about themselves. Some people who are not good at work, but they are very good at talking. Right, and then they will be like, you know, the practice is amazing. So many people we have seen in our class, you know, who have passed their BDS, MDS, multiple trials are doing much better than the gold medalist, simply because he or she is not able to portray what he or she is doing. So you need to find out where are you, and to fill up your business of dentistry should have people filled with all these personalities, because each personality has a role to play in the roadmap that you create for your practice. Okay, so I'll go very fast. I'll have to skip this value chains, but value chains basically means like what I'll tell you. What is a value chain, or what is a chain? Chain is a series of instructions or a series of work which gets triggered at the first instance, and it gets passed on from one person to the other, or within the same person he has to perform. Let's say, what is a chain? A chain is like an amalgam restoration. So there is a chain, right? That you just don't do the filling. You just don't gain access and do filling. So there is a chain of events that occurs. Similarly, one or more person can be associated in that task. So there is a chain. You must have a proper communication for that chain. Now, if you have said one thing to somebody, that person has told another thing to another person. At the fifth person, when the chain has got more than five people in a verbal communication, no written communication, your communication can get overturned. You know, you have many videos coming in where the people stand in line. And then one person does a sign language and tells the other person to replicate that sign. Then it goes to the last person standing on the line. And when he comes back and tells the original person who has first created the sign is exactly the opposite or entirely something different. So this is how your chains can get disturbed in communication. Try to shorten the chain. Let there be as less number of people, as less number of intervention. There may be redundancies. You know, some person will say, "Hey, mere ko nahi karne ka hai." Remove him from that chain. Put somebody who will do that job for you. Okay. The moment you feel that one person is doing the job but is not doing it properly, so the chain is actually not performing the way it should be, then strengthen it by strong means, by training the people. And sometimes a chain is broken because somebody who is sick has not come. So you must be at a position where that person who is in the chain of events which occurs for a particular procedure, be it your dental procedure which you are performing on the patient, or accounting, or ordering process, or invoicing, or collection. That chain has to be repaired, otherwise your work will not get done and nobody is answerable for it just because that one person in between was absent, missing, or he failed to do it. So this is what you mean by a value chain. We can go on talking about it, but because of lack of time. You see, why the systems, procedures in Japan, I'll give you an example of Japan. Edward Deming is the person who made Japan what it is today simply by introducing system, procedures and processes into Japan post-World War after Japan was destroyed. There is always a scope for improvement. Never say that. Even I say that I also need to improve on lots of aspects, right? Not only improve myself, but all the processes that I'm doing, the way I'm doing, how I'm doing, the way I'm doing, they all continuously need to be updated. I basically got trained in MDS with bags appliance. Not only bag appliance, we had no direct bonding. We used to do bending on all the teeth and building each bracket. Now, if I still continue doing it, if I have not improved myself. Secondly, the improvement that we are looking at, if it is not stimulating, so try to do things which stimulates you and improve those areas, and your practice will get leverage. We'll be talking in detail on part 3 on inception marketing, selling, buying criteria, and engagement pitches. Right now, we also have these marketing campaigns. Now you see, never underestimate the power of a snail mail. What is a snail mail? It's a very simple thing. It's a letter posted or courier to somebody. It's called snail because it goes slowly. But never underestimate a personal contact in a snail mail. Your brochures, business cards are your free PR. Please understand one thing. Your business card should not be a brochure, and your brochure should not be a business card. There is a huge difference between the two. Your business card should have a particular area and it should reflect what you are.
All right, you can generate. We already talked about internet marketing, sales and automated system and funnels. We're going to discuss this in detail in the part three. What exactly is an automated system? Now, let me give you an example. I am Dr. Amish Mehta. Today, I'm speaking to you all. Tomorrow, if I want to convert this into a business, what will happen is that I will have a website. I will have a login, username, password, wherein there is a payment gateway. And all my videos are uploaded. Nobody needs to actually come online. He or she can actually log in. All the videos are recorded. We have interaction once or twice in a month. And then we have a video conferencing. And what happens is that that person pays the money. I am basically not doing anything. It's an automated online system where the money is getting generated. Now, Amazon, for example, the owner of Amazon may be sleeping, but still their work is it's still generating revenue. So that is what you mean by sales and automated systems. And the funnels is a very important thing. Funnel is like this. So when you have a target audience, how to boil them down to a particular procedure that you want to target. You want to increase your practice for clear aligners. You just can't market yourself for clear aligners. You must have a broad base of people whom you think will go in for clear aligners. And then slowly that they get filtered. And from that, the final person comes out. 5 to 10 people from 1,000 people that you have targeted will be your clear aligner patient. So that is the importance of funnel marketing. So we will now, these are videos and some things of my patients which we used in part one, but I will skip that. We will now go to the part two of the presentation. Just give me some time that I open up. Yeah, there we are. And I'll start sharing the screen. Okay, so there we go. This is part two. Now we'll talk in detail about the iceberg. Now, what does iceberg mean? Icebergs are things or situations that you foresee which might affect your business. As simple as that. Now, I have certain examples of icebergs here. Okay. For example, your practice has only one supplier for one particular product. What if he goes out of business? What if something happens to him? God forbid something happens. There are people who, you know, when this migration started to Canada, one of my printer who I was relying on for 20 years to print my Diwali cards, he migrated to Canada, right? And he gave me only 15 days notice that we are not going to print your Diwali card. We have no contingency plan. You know, it took me overnight. I had to search somebody who understands the entire process because we had a systemized procedure of doing things. I never foresaw. So, but now I have 2 to 3 printers readily available who understands my requirement. Okay. There is one particular product which we are using. I'll give an example, and that is known as Sephoride. It is basically silver diamine fluoride, which is used for treating caries deciduously in pediatric patients, which are very scary of getting a restoration done. What Sephoride silver diamine fluoride does is that it simply arrests your caries, period. But when it gets arrested, it becomes black. So now when it becomes black, it is anesthetic. So it is usually done only in deciduously. There was only one supplier in the whole country. He stopped importing it. Our practice, pediatric practice, was so much dependent on silver diamine fluoride. So then now we have at least 2 to 3 people, 2 to 3 different. Sephoride is a generic, is a trade name of one particular. Checking here. Phagamine, yeah. So there is another one as Phagamine. So thank you, Akhil, for that input. So you see, there we now have these multiple products. So it's you should not be dependent. Your practice can get destroyed because you know your product is not available with which you are used to. So your supply lines should be very clear. There is one particular assistant or one particular person in your practice on whom you are relying heavily. You have no alternative. You have no immediate replacement. That is the biggest iceberg. And I'm telling you, I'll go back to the slide, which is the biggest iceberg. I told you the biggest iceberg is ourselves. God forbid something happens to me tomorrow. What will happen to my practice? Do I have some assistants or some doctors who will look after my practice in my absence? If not equally efficient, but to sufficiently efficient to the extent that we can sustain our practice, right? So you need to understand this iceberg. And you see, nobody is free from trouble. Who would have foreseen this today? The whole world has come to a standstill today. Every equation, everything has gone for a six, right? So a change in the economy, for example, technical development from your computer. I may be the best dentist in town, but somebody who is my competitor gets a better technology, markets it well. All my patients realize that, oh, this Dr. Amish Mehta is doing something old stuff. This doctor has got a newer technology, he's doing it much better efficiently. And these are his success stories and testimonials online, blah, 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 with all full internet and SEOs and ethical branding in place. Where were you? Are you equipped? Are you prepared? Overnight, you will have to do something so that you can now generate. So you must see that iceberg, have a plan in place. If this happens, then this, right? A change in the legislation. Tomorrow, there will be huge changes in the legislation that we please, please understand. This post-COVID days, there is going to be a legislation now, the way we can practice dentistry. I am pretty sure that there is going to be a change. If not now, immediately in 6 months. What are the likely legislations that can change place? Next week, I'll be doing a webinar on that. How do we prepare ourselves to changing times? Right? A competitor all of a sudden has a better marketing plan. You have no marketing plan at all. Market gets flooded. You know, there are dentists everywhere. Who would have foreseen this? Your relationship with your employees? Worry. Right? It can be difficult. Just a minute, please. Just give me a minute. I'm really sorry for that disturbance. There was a call which came for an emergency. The patient, one MBBS doctor, has fallen and his front teeth are. It's a law of attraction. I talk of traumatized dentition, and these days all I'm getting patients in emergency are all the people who have got, you know, trauma. So we are dealing with that in the most efficient manner as we can, with you know, full PPEs in place, and this, they charge you a bomb. You know, a single PPE these days is costing more than 1500 rupees, and we need two people, three people in the OT, and you wear 4,500 rupees worth of PPE. And so, you know, you have to definitely pass on that cost to the patient. So this is all that I'm going to talk about, that you see the way that we are going to practice tomorrow. You see, what is the biggest threat tomorrow is you getting COVID in dentistry, right? But are you going to sit at home and do nothing? I'm going to get COVID. Are you going to stop your practice? Prepare yourself. So this is an iceberg which is there right in front of you. It is looming out in front of you. Let's get equipped with it. Let's get on with it. And let's do something about it rather than sitting and cribbing. Kya hoga abhi? PP nahi mil raha. Call 10 people. Find out resources. Okay. I'm trying to create a, you know, with some groups, you know, we are trying to do a bulk purchase. Let's all get together and let's all try to, you know, face the competition and try to bring the prices down. A lot of, you know, IMA, for example, in a city nearby is very active. It is placing 50,000 PPE orders to cater to the needs of the doctors in that particular area. So these are all the, how you, you know, look at and you fight. So these are all the various, you know, threats that can come. So I'm going to give you an exercise now, is that brainstorm and think all the potential iceberg that your practice could face tomorrow. They could be both internal as well as external. Okay, for example, now I'll give you two examples here of Rosetta Stone and Duolingo. Those of you who are into language learning, and if you are fond like me to learn newer languages, you know, there used to be a Rosetta Stone online series which was chargeable, where you can learn a language. And in came Duolingo, and Duolingo started offering the same thing free. Okay, free. That you want to learn Latin, okay, I'm going to teach you Latin. I'm not going to charge you money for that. So Rosetta Stone never, they thought that how long will they survive? And so they never changed their business plan, and Duolingo became more famous. Now the whole point is that from where was the Duolingo getting the money? You see, what they were doing was that they were actually into translating services. All right, and they were charging a bomb because there used to be like a person who wants to translate from Latin to English. From where will you find people? So they already have a person who is learning Latin, and that same same work which they took from somebody to translate, they used to give it to the student as an exercise to translate it. And then, so the student was actually doing their job free. So they were earning money from a different source, and they used to charge the embassies, they used to charge the governments. You see, for example, there is a communication between the Russian government and the Indian government, that the Russian doesn't understand Hindi or English, and we don't understand Russian. So now all the communication needs to be translated. So you hire a translating agency, so an interpreter. So this Duolingo started hiring interpreters, okay? And those, they were giving them those material, and they were charging money from them. And those were given as exercises to people. So this is how we are generating. Now, for example, in our practice, you know, we sell these oral healthcare products. My assistants sell, I don't sell. And it is a source of earning for them. And they are retained because they have an extra source of income. So these are the things that you could learn, you know, how they are going to talk on what business you are and how you can generate revenue from your existing dental practice from other arenas as well, okay? Now, let me understand one thing from all of you. All of you know the LPs, you know, these turntables and this big black colors disc which were coming on a gramophone which were played, which was then that industry completely got wiped off when the cassettes came in. And when the CDs came in, the CD industry got wiped off. When the DVDs came, the DVD industry. And now when you have this online video and you have got all everything on the touch of a button, the CD business is gone, the DVDs, you see. So did people foresee that? No, they thought that this is going to die. But every time we always say that this is not going to affect my business. But you must identify all the icebergs and you must go. So these are the various things which can be optimized with proper foresight and action. So you do that exercise. The second exercise is, see, we all have certain fears in our mind. Come up with two or biggest fears that you have for your practice, or you can say an iceberg, like, what if somebody sues you? What if somebody takes you to the Consumer Protection Act, right? So what if that happens? What are you? Do you have a lawyer in place? Do you have all the systems? Do you have enough defense? Have you maintained all the records? Are you being particular about everything? Are all the consent forms and everything duly signed? Everything is in place or not? That is your contingency plan. So this is an example. This is exercise number two. Now we're going to go on roadmaps. What exactly is a roadmap? Roadmap is something which looks like this. You know, you are the top here. You are the president. You are the manager. In a dental practice, you are also doing the accounting, you are doing the bookkeeping, you are taking care of the payables and receivables. Initially, with a one chair, two chair practice with two staff, you and your staff will be in all these boxes, right? But as your practice grows, you need to exit. For example, in the operations, you should only be doing the dental procedures. All these other boxes should be filled by subordinate staff. That is how your staff will and your practice will increase. For example, there is a salesperson. For example, there is a person who is solely concentrating on receivables. You have raised the invoices. You have lakhs of rupees outstanding. Patients have to pay you. You don't sit and call. There is already somebody. But if you don't have too much of a practice, put your name there. Every morning, see which are the receivables. Which patient does not, give them a phone call. To my experience, they all pay up. There will be some people. There are always all type of people in this world. Okay. There is one particular patient whom we chased for money, became very nasty with us. Okay. And then he started, you know, blaming us. So you see this game. So take advance money, because people, when they don't want to pay money, they will find excuses. We are not happy with your service. You see, these are the people who don't want to pay up. Right? I have patients who, in case the implant has failed, yet they have paid me full money and not asking for a return. Even when we do a replacement of an implant, they sometimes pay you the service fee. Some people whom you say implant is successful, but he's cribbing, ye lagta hai, khana phasta hai, ye nahi hai, theek nahi hai, paisa nahi denge. So these are the things which you need to take care by a proper management system. So prepare a roadmap, whether you have one, whether you are the only person in your clinic. Fill your name everywhere in this roadmap. What are the roles? What are the functions that are to be done every day in your practice? Fill up those boxes. Don't leave any box empty. Right now, write your name in it. As and when you grow, your aim should be, when your practice is getting leveraged, your aim should be to take your name out of most of the boxes other than treating the patient. Even after 25-30 years, you will have to bring yourself out of that box. So start planning how you're going to put somebody else in that box in time so that he or she succeeds, can take over your practice either by paying you a hefty amount of royalty or by a profit sharing equation. The next is the problem is, you know, like, you see, what will happen is when you have got 5 patients today, your name is there in each box. Tomorrow, 100 patients, your name is still there in each box. And that is why when the practice goes, you actually start becoming more busier. You don't have, you have less time for your family. You have less time for your breaks. You have less time for your hobbies. You are continuously doing your job, nothing else. So this is the biggest problem that a lot of practice owners, they face in this country. There are times when another person, there may be some person who is holding too many places in that particular boxes. And when he leaves, you are going to shift yourself in those boxes, which again is going to make you even more busier, and your business can actually, at that particular time, your practice can become less efficient. Now, like you see, you fill somebody, you entrust a job to somebody. You don't know his needs. You don't know his personality type, and you entrust his job. He's going to hate it from the bottom of his heart, right? And he's not going to do anything. The moment you identify his real need and you identify his real personality and you put him in a role, for example, an accountant. You know, an accountant should not be an extroverted person. He cannot be a dreamer. He has to be an absolutely introverted, practical person because he's dealing with facts and figures. There's nothing ambiguous about it. Itna paisa aaya to aaya, nahi aaya to nahi aaya. Kharch hua to hua, kamaye to kamaye. Kuch fixtures to nahi ho sakta hai na ki ye 100 rupiya hai, iska matlab ye 120 bhi ho sakta hai, 90 rupiya bhi ho sakta hai. Right? He cannot be a dreamer and an extrovert, just keeps talking and doesn't maintain the books and accounts. So if you don't put that kind of a person, if your accountant is not having that personality, you know, you need to put somebody who is having that personality into that box of accounting. So what is a role map? It's an organizational chart showing who answers to whom within a company. Not only that, but it also is position dependent and not person dependent. That is very important. You see, it is role dependent, and a person who fits that role has to be put there. Initially, we have to place ourselves in all those roles. And we have to do multitasking because we don't have enough practice. But once our practice grows, we have to come out of that multitasking equations and we have to enter. You can get people to actually work free for you. For example, somebody in your family who is looking for some part-time work and is willing to do it and is very good at it. I do it. My brother helps me from around the country, settled down in North America, but he still helps me. Right? My mother, for example, she does a lot of management in my practice. So we have this kind of, you know, roles to play where people engage people, and you can have lot of manpower that works for you. You may be having a friend who is in need for a part-time job. We don't need to have a full-timer to fill in your role. Actually, for dentistry, we don't need full-timer other than our dental assistants and clinical staff and a receptionist, of course. All the rest of the staff can be part-time, or they can also work from home, for example, which is the need of the hour today. So you see, because one individual has either multiple positions, you need, your role should be to eliminate so that your company is not reliant on one person for too many roles. By properly working out a role chart, you can also slowly take yourself out of your world and still generate revenue, still earn money, still pursue your passions of, you know, hobbies and etc. So this is the role map exercise which I'm going to give you. Create a role map with all positions that are within your practice. Okay, with the example I already gave. Populate that position with somebody, either with your name or employee's name. And now highlight each role. Red means which needs an immediate action to change. You yourself see in accounting, you're not good at accounting. You need to hire a part-time accountant. They come and do the job pretty efficiently. Mark it as red. The people that which you feel that needs to change but with not immediate effect, mark it blue. And the roles which you feel, for example, you as a dentist, you know, are in that role where you are doing all the dental procedures. It is absolutely green. You don't need to change. You are young. You are 35 years old. But yes, if you are 75 years old, if you are 70 years old, that position becomes red or blue, because eventually somebody else will have to come and do the job for you, because you age is not catching up with you, and you may end up having a complete stoppage of your practice, right? See, God forbid, we hear so many, you know, sad stories. This is young dentist dying at a very young age, 30 years, 35 years, 50 years. You see that, I have seen that in my city. I have seen across India, a lot of people have come across. Now, you see, the another aspect, we have another 15, 20 minutes to go. What practice are you in? What do you mean by what practice are you in? That means that have you ever identified what kind of practice you are doing? Okay, so are we what kind of practice? Now, you see, there are different types of dental practices today. Is your clinic a high-end clinic where you are catering to very high, costly dental treatments? Are you having a neighborhood practice? Are you having an exclusive practice where only you are doing endodontics, you are doing only orthodontics, you are doing only prosthodontics? you're doing only, you know, let's say, for example, you are restricting yourself to restorative dentistry. So these are the kind of things that you need to ask. Okay, one thing. This is an audit, right? So right now, whatever you are doing, that is what I'm asking you to measure it. Okay, the second thing is, what other things that I can also do, which I'm not doing right now? You have to identify these two things to leverage your practice. Okay. One thing is that you see, you may be doing something. Try to find out how much revenue you are earning from each procedure that you are doing, and try to concentrate more on procedures which is generating not only higher revenue but also increased profitability. You may be earning 3 lakh rupees from one patient, but the cost is 2,90,000. You are only earning 10,000 rupees. For what? You are working for the company. I know of people who are using, you know, this aligners, and they charge only like 20,000-25,000 rupees more other than the cost of the aligners. Why don't you do conventional braces? That is the amount that you are earning from conventional braces. You are incurring a cost of 1.5-2 lakh rupees. You are working for yourself or you are working for the company. So you need to understand all this. Try to find out profitability. Profitability is most important. In our times, dentistry was 400% profitable. Every 100 rupees that we were spending, we are earning 400 rupees. Right now, every 100 rupees that we are earning, we are only earning 40 rupees. The profitability has come down to 40%. It has become 1/10. So now you have to identify which procedure that you are doing. Which, again, I'm not saying only go for profitability. What do you enjoy the most? Which are your passions that you like doing more? The law of attraction is very strong. The moment you start doing what you love, those kind of patients are going to get attracted to you. If you don't, please tell me what is going wrong. I will help you get there. No, see, when I'm asking you what business you are actually in, it's not sarcastic, right? Ask yourself what your practice is and what you are providing and what your practice could be and what you could also provide. So what your practice is not only defined by the services you provide, but it encompasses the entire industry, who, what type of patients are, what are their needs, what are their wants, and what are your internal operations. Many practices confine to what they think they are. Right, I think that I can only do this much, and that is why I failed to ask who really I am. Right, I was told by people, my own friends, that, you know, Amish, you are such a good extrovert person, why don't you start teaching people? Right, and that is why 20 years back I joined a college, and I love teaching, that's my passion. I earn like, you know, a minuscule of money other than my practice, but I still love why I'm coming here online. Why am I utilizing this time to teach people? Because I realize what really I am and what I could be tomorrow. God forbid if I don't have a practice tomorrow, at least I have a speaker business for me. So these are the times that you can, that hidden talents inside you, what also you can do. There is this, you know, one dentist whom I used to know, he used to come and observe me from his BDS days, and his father used to tell him, then he used to, I used to be his mentor. And his wife, for example, she passed her BDS and was helping him. I went to one of this soft skill exhibitions where there is a soft skill. There is a person who's a soft skill trainer in my BNI chapter, and she invited me there. And I was surprised to find that person sitting there. I said, "What are you doing here?" She said, "I have, you know, diversified part of my practice into medico-facial aesthetics." Wow! Same dental chair. You're also performing medical. You do Botox. You do all this laser treatment. And you see all this. Ortho patients, they come with their mothers, you know, you just say, we also provide this service, get somebody to do it for you, you could be earning money, you know, out of that. So right now the legislation is such that dentists are legally qualified to do medico-facial aesthetics. The biggest threat when you do a threat and a SWOT analysis for medico-facial aesthetics is if tomorrow the legislation comes and we cannot work. But that is a very far-fetched. I have a business plan in ready for a medico-facial aesthetic, but because of lack of time and because I have undergone a training, I have not starting it. But the business plan is ready. We can always talk about it if you want to understand a little more. Every practice wants to be successful and expand. But think of expansion as a growing patient piece. You see, you may have the same number of patients. What I do is that I don't concentrate on more patients. I concentrate on more procedures to be done in the same number of patients. How about it? It's so simple. You see, end of the day, it is the number of procedures which is giving us the revenue. It is not the number of patients. You may be treating 1,000 patients, and each patient is giving you 1,000 rupees revenue. You are earning 10 lakh rupees a year. But if you are having 100 patients which are generating 100 procedures worth 10,000 rupees, you earn 1 crore rupees a year.
So this is how you should think laterally. All right. Expansion can be much more internal. It is, see, just increasing the number of chairs is not expansion, right? It is physical expansion. I expand myself into 5 clinics without having any procedure set, any SOPs set. I'm going to miserably fail, right? So you need to first internally expand. Try to expand with least investment. Try to find out areas where you could also provide service at a least cost, right? So look at your current practice resources, what your current patients want. See, understand one thing. It is very different thing. I want to change this slide. It is not only need. There are two things. One is need and another is my want. My wants and my needs may not be the same. Most of the times they are different. I want something because XYZ has it, right? But do I need it? Wow, I don't care. Okay, I need it. But if I don't want it, what I'll do is I'll always put it on the back burner. I'm not going to do it. So this is the way that you can have a look at it. Opportunities. I'm sorry, I'm not speaking for Ivoclar here, but look at this, guys. You see, there used to be an Opera Gate. Opera Gate is a retractor which all we CERAC users, which we do all this direct scanning and we do single day restorations. We use this Opera Gate for, you know, it's a very nice retractor. They have come up with an innovation because now the legislation is may going to come where you may have to use rubber dams for minimization of aerosols. So now what will happen here is that we need to understand this, and tomorrow, see, they are already there. They are marketing it that, you know, their company head for India has already sent me a WhatsApp message saying that, doc, we are prepared. When are you placing an order? This is an Optra dam, easy to place. This is what you call opportunities. All these persons into this mask making, they have diversified them into PPEs. Tomorrow, you see, I have already talked with 4 people in the morning and we have evolved a business plan. That how are we going to cater to the increased needs of the dentist post-COVID, right? I already told them I can be a subject expert. You are the people who can do all the manufacturing and we could generate business out of it. Why don't you think these are the resources which can today, which are so important. Now, by you see, the biggest thing, you know, if you want to learn something, start teaching that. And you will be amazed or start helping people learn that. You will be amazed how fast you learn. All these things that I'm talking to you today, even after this 4th or 5th lecture that I'm taking in this webinar series, I have said something today which I have not said in the previous 2 because I learned from teaching. So, you know, now your exact exercise number 1 on this will be to write out a clear description of what your practice is right now, which is your ideal target market according to the services that you are providing and what other services you can provide to them. What are their other wants? Try to identify that. Also write down, how are you going to expand your practice with existing resources? This example I'll give you of Richard Branson. This Richard Branson is the owner of Virgin Airways. Now you see, he had a whole accounting department which was actually not utilized to the optimal level and he was paying them money. What he did was he started an accounting firm and he started taking outsourcing accounting business from other people. And so no extra revenue, no extra investment, extra revenue. See, you have to think literally. Today, if I have space, why don't I put a facial bed? I get some dentist trained in medico-facial aesthetics and there you go. You have a surplus like a 5 by 10 feet space. You can start a medico-facial aesthetic business right over there. Exercise number 3 is write down your target audience and who your patients are and what are the some things that they need or want, which provide you are not providing right now. So this is the way that you can generate the same, within the same database of your patients. Now you are generating more procedures and more revenue. Then, see, what is freedom? We can keep talking about it. But the idea of that roadmap is that ultimately, your goal that if I want to retire at the age of 65, I should retire with a plan that I am free. I am not working yet. My business is running without me. So that is your target. You want to retire at 40, 50 is your call. But you should also know what are you going to become? What do you want to do after retirement? Because after 15 days sitting at home, you will still want to go back to your practice. So have a plan, very crystal clear, 50 years of age, 60 years of age. I want to become free from my practice, yet earn the same amount of money. So this is the way that you can do. So ask yourself these things, and this exercise is very good, very clear about the future journal. Write down what if this can happen and thank the universe that it has already happened and see how beautifully you attract that thing into your life, right? So I'm going to cut short on this part today. It's because we are just 5-10 minutes away from the time. I don't want to exceed my time. So write down a future journal. Don't limit yourself to your business. Write about your personal life. Where do you, are you seeing in your personal life after 10 years, 15 years? Write that journal and work, start working towards that goals. Goal setting is again very different from your future journal. What is it that you want in life? What is it that you are passionate about? Follow that goals, and you see, once you have a goal, you will reach that target. People do not realize their goals. People do not make role planning, goal planning, and that is why they fail to achieve the goal. Thank you very much, all of you, for your patient hearing. You see, I have cut down a 4 hours webinar into 2 hours webinar. So I am extremely sorry if I went very fast for all of you, but time was indeed very stressed and pressed. So I could not do much. I have tried to record this session also, which I would be planning to put it on my website. All you will need to do is have a username and a login password. We will be setting up the business very shortly about the speaker thing, which you can register yourself, where you have access to all the recordings. Thank you very much. I'm going to mute everybody now, unmute everybody. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask me now.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
So you can unmute yourself if you want to talk. And if you have any questions, or you could put it in the chat box. In the meanwhile, I'll stop sharing the screen. All right, so there we go. I have lots of errands to run at home. You know, these days, if somebody tomorrow, if I go to a hotel and if they tell me that we are going to make you feel at home, the first thing that I'm going to tell them is I'm not going to mop the floor, because that is what I do at home these days. So,
thank you very much, sir.
The whole equation of making you feel at home is going to change tomorrow. And you see, try to do things that you love. If you are in a bad mood, please go out to the balcony, listen to some nice music and come back. Because I see a lot of people are undergoing a lot of stress these days. You are staying with your family members. There is no break. There can be lots of things which can go in a household. Try to be very congenial to your family, and try to bring a balance everywhere. May God bless you all. And I would... Okay, so Doc wanted I stage videos and quick summarization if possible. Okay, sure. Sure, Vijay, I'll try to do that. You can do that if you want to. Paperless script practice. Okay, Samir. Paperless practice is very good, and nowadays it is going to be the norm. There are less amount of paper in your practice, less amount of paper which can transmit infection. The only thing about paper practice is you must have a good backup. Either it should be on the cloud, which is easily retrievable, or if it is on your local hard disk, please make sure that you take a backup daily. I would any day advocate. My practice is 90% paperless. It is only those people who want a paper, we give them a paper. We call that a tissue anyways. You discuss 7 human needs. How do you recognize what the patient needs? Well, that is why you need to connect with the patient, you know. That is why, you see, there is something known as triage. This is pre-screening of the patient. And you must have a form. You must like to know. There are actually columns in our practice when we give the patient to fill the dental and medical history. There are actually columns which identifies his or her hobbies. And from that, you can know what his need might be. From his behavior, how he walks in, your staff can brief you, sir, this guy has been sitting for half an hour. And he's been very particular about everything, you know. So that means that his need is certainty. That is this person who is continuously going to the reception area and saying, "Mera number kab aayega?" He is looking for significance. Does it answer your question, sir? You need to. Yar, thoda apko na kabhi apne clinic se bahar waiting area mein jana padega yar. कभी कभी अपने को पेशेंट के साथ बातचीत करना पड़ेगा उनको उनको समझने का उनको देखने का एंड डोंट मेक हिम फील दैट यू आर एक्चुअली ऑब्जर्विंग टेक द फीडबैक फ्रॉम द स्टाफ कैसा रहा ये पेशेंट कैसा है तुम्हारा ओपिनियन क्या हैव अ सिस्टम इन प्लेस यू नो दैट द स्टाफ इन्फॉर्म्स यू इन एडवांस ये किट किट वाला है ये ऐसा करता है उससे आइडिया आ जाता है कि इसकी नीड क्या है पर पैसे की बहुत किट किट करता है और कोई बात नहीं बोलता है कि भाई मैं इधर क्यों आया यू नो वेटिंग रूम में बैठ के थोड़ा जिग जिग कर रहा है कि कहाँ है डॉक्टर क्या है सो ही इज लुकिंग फॉर ग्रोथ सो देयर आर सर्टेन थिंग्स वो आने के बाद आपको क्वेश्चन जो पूछता है यू नो क्वेश्चंस पूछता है द वे ही आस्क्स यू क्वेश्चंस यू नो यू सी व्हाट आई डू इन माय प्रैक्टिस आई मेक माय पेशेंट्स आस्क क्वेश्चंस एंड आई केटर टू देम एंड आई हैव 5000 वीडियोस एंड एवरीथिंग इज टच स्क्रीन इंटरएक्टिव थिंग्स इन द ट्रियाज रूम वेयर वी कैन यू नो इजीली आइडेंटिफाई ये आदमी को क्या चाहिए
अगर मेरे स्टाफ को लगता है ना तो मुझे बुलाते हैं कि सर जरा देखो ना इसको क्या चाहिए. सी दैट इज व्हाट वी मीन बाय नीड राइट. वो मराठी में नहीं बोल तुम्हारा काय पाहिजे यार काय खाली पीली किटपिट करता तुम्ही बराबर. सो अपने को कभी पता नहीं चलता है कि उसका नीड क्या है. नो आदमी को क्या चाहिए भाई तेरे को लाइफ में. तो अपने को आइडेंटिफाई करना पड़ता है वो सेवन नीड्स से कि ये सेवन नीड्स में से इसकी पर्सनालिटी ये टाइप की है तो ही माइट बी हैविंग दिस नीड. ओके आई यूज प्रैक्टो आई यूज डू इट एंड आई यूज डॉल्फिन. आई हैव थ्री डिफरेंट सॉफ्टवेयर्स. डॉल्फिन एंड डू इट आर ऑफलाइन सॉफ्टवेयर्स व्हिच आर देयर इन अवर आईटी. वी हैव अ कॉमन सर्वर एंड आई यूज प्रैक्टो ऑनलाइन. ओ यूज क्लिनिशिया. ओके दैट्स अ गुड थिंग गुड इनपुट. You're most welcome, Nisar. Any more questions? See, I have, you know, back-to-back so many webinars. I have a webinar in BNI on Friday morning. I've got a webinar tomorrow. I have been working since 7 in the morning preparing presentations. I could just barely manage to reach in time today for this webinar here. But I had promised a lot of people that I'll be retaking the part 1 and part 2 before I go to part 3 of leveraging my lawyer practice. First stage pick summarization. I did not understand your question, Vijay. What do you exactly mean by first stage pick summarization? I'm sorry, I think he's offline. So are there any other questions here? Vijay, do you have any questions? When is the next webinar? Okay, it is on Friday at 4 o'clock, part 3. And there will be a webinar on adjunctive orthodontics tomorrow at 12 o'clock, but it is a Colgate event. So I'll be sharing the link on the all the WhatsApp groups that I have. If anybody who is not a member of my WhatsApp groups, I would... Please note down my number here. Please text me a message. Within a couple of hours, I'll be adding you in that group. Tomorrow at 12 o'clock, the participation limit is only 250 people. The webinar is going to be all India. So please come in time. Please click on the link. It's basically, I am an expert speaker for Colgate. I've been speaking for Colgate for the last 15 years now. And so they approached me to conduct a webinar for themselves. The topic is adjunctive orthodontics, enhancing the art of dentistry. A multidisciplinary viewpoint. All right. So all of you, I'll be putting again that. So that is tomorrow at 12 o'clock. Thursday, I have not yet decided, but mostly I'll be doing a webinar on how to enhance your practice by doing certain orthodontic procedures. Thinking beyond orthodontics, within orthodontics, but beyond orthodontics. But that webinar will be exactly, wanted to know first presentation picks, which you skipped. Oh, there were patients. You want to see them, Vijay? They were patients. Okay, so let me go. You want to see the patients? All right, fine. Thank you so much. So I will be going back. Leveraging your practice part 2. Leveraging your practice part 1. Where is that now? Okay, let me find out. Just give me a minute. I'll have to reopen that presentation. Okay, Bagul. Vijay, please bear with me till such time. Okay, so there we are. Okay. So this is what I use as a PR activity. Any patient coming in my practice with buck teeth, for example. Oh, sorry, I'm not sharing the screen. Very, very untidy of myself. Okay, so now I have shared my screen. So you see, this is a video actually, which I show. This is a PR activity, a free PR marketing tool. You see this video, as you can see, how this child turned into a gentleman with orthodontic treatment. I use the dolphin video making tool of my dolphin software. And this is how we generate. Isn't it wonderful to see? Like if you have a patient who comes in with buck teeth, then if you show him this video, the chances of him getting converted, even if you're charging 10,000 rupees more, you know, are very high because now he has a visual impression of, and he also have a dolphin treatment simulator, which we use to show them how they are going to look like after the practice. I mean the treatment. So this is another favorite video of mine, which you see this kind of trauma that I got with subluxative intrusion of our upper six anterior teeth. And this video, which I shared, which I show to all my patients, is this. So this is the way he or she can get completely transformed. All natural teeth with adjunctive orthodontics. This is the patient, as you can see, before, during the treatment and after the treatment. So these are a few ortho cases I want to show. This is a balista spring, which I used, a modified balista spring with a 1725 TMA arch wire. And this video shows how the canine got disimpacted, which is very useful to show patients who fail to understand how are we going to disimpact their teeth. So this video goes a long way in showing them. As you can see, this is how we generate the video. That is why using good softwares, you know, can be very, very good. So you can see this video again. If you are not an orthodontist, even if you're a dentist, wouldn't this amaze you? It will make your task much simpler about disimpactions, you know, of forced surgical orthodontic eruption or impacted. This video I used to show my patients of how I'm going to expand their arches, how it is going to change their arch, you know. So this is a video, it all goes with the retainer also in place. So the retention question automatically comes from the patient, doc, what is that wire, right? So these are all the hints and tips that you give the patients to ask you questions. And they understand the most when they ask you questions and you answer them. The next slide is again, like a multidisciplinary work, a patient had undergone, you know, six upper and six lower crowns done without root canal and was not happy with the treatment. So we placed temporary crowns. This is the cephalogram, this is the OPG. We placed temporary PMMA crowns using the CIRAC technology. And then we created the space, we brought the to Walton's ratios, and then we used Invisalign in the lower and we corrected with Invisalign. So this is just to show you a multidisciplinary approach. This is with the final EMAX crowns in place. These are the progress, and you can see before, after, and in between. That is the OPG. You can see we did not replace the upper because upper mesiodistal dimensions were good enough. The patient was not happy with the mesiodistal dimensions in the lower teeth. So this is all we had. Now this is something which is, so this is a brushing technique which I show to all my patients, which normally, so this is a licensed version. So this kind of things are a PR tool. You know, we keep running them in our practices. The patients really understand very well this kind of instructions. So visual aids are used. This is to show them how to use an interdental brush with braces going on. We also have a video where no braces, so how to use an interdental brush. So these things are very visual and it helps, you know, very nice. And you can see all this is licensed. Now when they see this license to Chandan Orthodontic Clinic, the patient feels very proud that my doctor is very genuine. He's not doing pirated work. What if somebody pirates your work? How do you feel about it? So thank you very much. This is one of my very happy patient. You can see the before and after traditional orthodontics, all four extraction case. So, so that's it from my side. I'll stop sharing the screen. And the next dolphin, from where do you get that? Okay, Akhil, dolphin is actually marketed by Essential Dental Products. And you can send me a WhatsApp message on my number. I'll share the person. There's Manish Sharma and Rajnish Sharma. They are the distributors for Dolphin in India. It's an American software. It's a little expensive, but it's worth an investment. Don't do a foreign trip one day, 1 year. Dolphin mein paisa invest karo. It will be amazing how you recover that money. Okay, Akhil. My pleasure always. So I have been talking nonstop for 2 hours and working for the last 13 hours. Got up at 6 o'clock in the morning and been doing, not to mention the housework. But also, we also are open for emergencies. I already handled 3 emergencies today. We also have an emergency tomorrow. We get a lot of trauma cases these days in my hospital. So there is one, I mean, we do get our share of work. And I just thank the universe at this point of juncture that in spite of this uncertainty everywhere, it is keeping me busy. It is giving me immense pleasure to contribute back to the society. So thank you very much, all of you, for tolerating me for the last 2 hours. I hope I was productive enough. And so with that, I think we can end the meeting if there are no more questions. Please be in touch. Regularly check the WhatsApp groups that we have for updates. Tomorrow at 12 o'clock, we have a Colgate expert lecture series on adjunctive orthodontics, enhancing the art of dentistry, a multidisciplinary viewpoint. And we have part 3 of the same series on Friday. And also a couple of orthodontic webinars on rapid maxillary expansion, canine disinfections, surgical orthodontics and other procedure. So keep watching. I will also have a webinar on single day restoration, single sitting implant placement, how you can use the CIRAC system or any digital system to place an implant and an immediate loaded crown within 2 hours. So keep watching my webinars. Let's keep in touch with each other and let's contribute to the society. Stay home, stay safe. Goodbye, everybody. If there are any questions, please ask now or in another 1 or 2 minutes, I'll be ending the webinar. Okay, Vijay, bye-bye. So I think it's bye-bye from all of you. So Vijay, I think you're talking on behalf of everybody. So everybody, bye-bye. Have a safe evening. Have a nice dinner and a lovely time with your family. Thank you. Bye-bye.